Infective endocarditis is an infection of the internal lining of the heart, mostly affecting its valvular structures. This disease is just so high yield because its presentation is non-specific, meaning it's often missed. Moreover, its prognosis is poor because infection easily spreads to other organs or parts of the heart. To boil it down to basics, at least remember my rhyme. A new murmur plus fever is an infected heaver until proven otherwise. In terms of its pathogenesis, it develops on valvular structures which have sustained endothelial damage. This serves as a great nidus for infection. However, colonization also induces further damage and thrombus formation. This is why it can eventually mature into a growing infected vegetation. It's important to classify different types of IE. Firstly, native valve endocarditis. This is really caused by three pathogens: staphylococcal, which is most common overall and associated with hospital-acquired infection; Viridin's group streptococci, which is associated with community-acquired IE; and enterococci. Then we have prosthetic valve endocarditis, which is divided into early infection, which has a poor prognosis, and late infection, defined as 1 year post-implantation. Finally, we like to consider right-sided endocarditis as a bit special because it's rarer and highly associated with IV drug use and Staphylococcus aureus. Let's focus on its assessment and clinical features. So on history, you should inquire about features of heart failure, like dyspnea on exertion, orthopnea, and paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. Features suggestive of emboli, like stroke symptoms, chest pain, and headache. And finally, constitutional symptoms, like night sweats, malaise, and fatigue. On examination, you should specifically look for your patient's mojo. Murmurs, which are found in up to 80% of patients. Osler's nodes, or the ouchie nodes, because they're the painful lesions found on the fingers. Janeway lesions, which are painless plaques on the palms. And finally, odd splinters in the nails, referring to splinter hemorrhages. Now, the diagnosis can be made using the modified Duke criteria. There are two parts to the major criteria. Firstly, positive blood cultures in two separate collections and evidence the endocardium is involved, for example, a positive echo showing vegetation. There are five minor criteria that form the FIVER acronym. This stands for fever, immunological phenomena like Osler nodes, vascular phenomena like Janeway lesions, evidence of infection with a single positive culture, and clear risk factors for the disease like IV drug use. Now, the criteria is fulfilled if you have two major or all the minor criteria. Management ideally requires a dedicated endocarditis team, including infectious diseases physicians, a cardiologist, and a cardiac surgeon. IV antibiotics are the mainstay of treatment. Beta-lactams are frequently used. Additionally, gentamicin helps to cover for gram-negative sepsis. Now, cardiac surgery is commonly done and indicated if it causes heart failure, significant vegetation, or emboli. Let's summarize with our mnemonics. On exam, look for a patient's mojo, murmurs, Osler nodes, Janeway lesions, and odd splinter hemorrhages. And finally, never forget, a new murmur plus fever is an infected heaver until proven otherwise. Thanks for watching Townsend Teachings. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe.